views and opinions of any of the guests of After Hours AM are not necessarily the views and opinions of After Hours AM, its hosts, its staff, or any of its affiliates.
Broadcasting live from the After Hours AM studio, Joel Sturgis and Eric
Welcome to this edition of After Hours AM. That's right, this is After Hours AM. I am your host, Joel Sturgis, right along with me,
Eric Olsen.
Hey, Eric, man. How you doing, man?
I am doing quite well.
Good.
I'm very, very excited. It's my favorite time of every 4 years.
Really? And what is that?
The Olympics.
Oh, yes, that is true. Every fourth year. You go crazy for that stuff, though. So I haven't watched it at all.
Dude!
I know, I've been so busy, man. I'm busy, busy, dude.
My soul has been Olympus.
Well, you know what? But here's the deal, is I did step in at 2005, and I got on demand. I bit the bullet and got a better cable package.
Yay!
Yes, I know. I mean, it's only been around for 10 years. And here I am. I finally, you know, bite the bullet. Okay, let's do this. Can't do it anymore. Can't stop progress. All right. Here we go. And I got to say, I know this is old for everybody. They're like, oh, yeah. I've had that for like 10 years now. But I've been gorging myself every night on Paranormal Witness. Because on demand, it's like, wow, who needs Netflix?
Exactly.
You know, it's like, wow. And it's included.
You so, get real cable like a real man. And
like a real man.
Chairs float out the window.
Like a real man.
And you can even watch the Olympics on its many, many channels.
Yes, I was never a man until just the other day. I mean,
well, thank goodness.
You can. Evidently, my wife had no hand in that. But
no.
None whatsoever.
You had the wool pulled over her eyes.
I did. I did for a very long. No, I'm kidding. Oh, anyhow. That has been quite interesting, and I realize that now I'm getting heckled and harassed via the Facebook feed.
I'll tell you what, though. You mentioned Paranormal Witness. It really is a great show, considering it's all, you know, let's face it, it's all reconstruction, it's all reenactment, right?
Sure.
There's nothing quote-unquote real.
No.
They do usually interview one or more of the people who
allegedly
had the experience, lived through it.
Yeah.
Now time.
Yes.
You know? But anyway, the way they do it, it's just simply a matter of it's a much higher quality level, let's face it, of production, of acting, mm-hmm. of storytelling, and it really is always a very compelling show. And it's back on the air now.
Yeah, it is. And
last week.
I didn't watch a lot of the show. I know, shame on me. Until now, I mean, I've caught some episodes here and there. I want to say it's even better, and I know I'm going to be hated here, better than Discovery Channel's A Haunting.
Oh, yes.
Because I know that's coveted. People love that Discovery Channel is the
haunted. No, I agree. I agree with you.
But I think it's better. But yes, I did finally step up. And I am a man now. Look at me. I had to shave and everything today. Woo-hoo!
You know, when you get cable, then that's it. That's all you need. You don't need a big truck.
Well, no, you don't need a big truck. You don't need anything to make yourself feel better.
You don't need to stuff your pants.
Well, hey, you know.
You're a man when you got cable. I'm a man now. Paranormal witness.
Yeah, I sprung my first chest hair today. So I'm pretty happy about that. So I know enough about me and my chest hair and cable. There's a lot going on in the world of the paranormal headlines, isn't there, man?
Oh, man!
So, without further ado, everybody go to Twitter. If you're not already there, your guys already know the drill. Twill. It's not like Elrfod. I'm going to get me that Wesley Webbit. No, you already know the drill. Go on over to Twitter and type in AM Haunted if you're not already following, of course. And follow along with us and you'll be able to see these.
AM Haunted, my friends. It is your paranormal news and entertainment spot.
If it is worth knowing,
it's there. I'm telling you.
Yeah.
So the thing, I mean, obviously it's wildly entertaining to hear us discuss the paranormal news, but it is, believe it or not, even more entertaining to be able to see the pictures that we're talking about,
or even click through
to some of these stories that we link to. So there you go, my friends. All righty then. New Resident Evil coming along in January.
I cannot wait. I love those movies.
Are you a fan?
I am. I have all of them on Blu-ray. I love those movies. I actually, back in the day, when I was more of a gamer, when I was in my early 20s, I used to love the video games. Resident Evil video games. Oh, special place.
You added through the game door.
Yes. Well, no, that's the most pure because that's what they all originated from, were the games.
How many movies have there been?
Oh, gosh. There's like one, two, five now. I want to say it's five. And there's a huge amount of the spin-off cartoon movies, if you want to go that route as well. But right now, the movie upcoming will tie everything together in this particular universe of Resident Evil.
Very cool. So, well, we have the video. We have the promo, preview, trailer, whatever you want to call it.
Sure.
Right there. It's appearing. You don't even have to click anywhere. It is right there on the @AMHaunted Twitter page. And I'll tell you,
Mima still
looks hot.
She does. I was just about to say that. She's a flat-out fox.
Did you know? Because a lot of people don't know this because she's been an actress for so long now.
Yeah.
She started off as a singer.
Really?
Yeah, she had an album. She had a CD that came out in the early 90s, and it was really pretty good.
Really? I had no idea.
She was young. I mean, think about it. That's 20 years ago.
That is like 20. I did not know she was a singer. I know I'd love to interview her. Never had the opportunity to, but you know, maybe we can make that happen, huh, Eric?
I think we should in conjunction with the film.
I think we should.
Coming out in January.
Definitely check that out. I might even go to the theater for that one.
Whoa now.
I know, right? Whoa, hold your horses. Don't get too excited now. I might even go to the theater.
You want to see a big old super tall Mila, I take.
I do, and I'd invite all of our listeners to come with me when it does come out, so maybe I'll announce when I'm going to go to the theater, and maybe I can have a few of the listeners come with me who can sit through this great, great movie together.
You will be like the Resident Evil Piper.
Sure, I'll just run around and, you know.
You'll lead them off the cliff.
I will. I'll tell them, you know, it's not Oscar worthy, but gosh darn, it's close.
Darn close. Well, just based on the response, seeing the retweets and the favorites, man, there is a big, big built-in following for Resident Evil.
There is. It's
5,700 retweets.
That's a lot of retweets, and most of people in my generation in the early 40s, late 30s, we came to it at the peer form through the video games. So we like the fact that the story does somewhat stay close to the game. So that's always nice.
I, having not played the game when I watched...
Shame on you! Shame on you!
I don't play any
games. May midgets come flog you.
They may. They may. They may well. I am just slightly too old to be a video gamer. Anyway, nonetheless, I had no idea what was going on in that first movie because I hadn't played the game.
See, Raccoon City is the big evil conglomerant.
Umbrella,
and they have
peculiar.
And they nuke Raccoon City in the game, even. Really, quite honestly, Umbrella Corporation, like the movie, made the zombies. There's going to be, hopefully, Leon Kennedy's in this edition. Hopefully. He is a major character in the games.
Well, it sounds like it is time for a reckoning and retribution.
Man, I'm a fanboy over here. I'm like, yeah.
You know all this stuff.
I know, right?
Wow. All right, moving along.
All right, let's
move. All righty then. So I originally, though I have lived in Ohio now for a long time, 26 years, actually.
Is it really?
Anyway, I am from Southern California originally, mm-hmm. and I enjoyed very much. It's not that well written, but it's an interesting, and there's cool pictures. The 10 most haunted cemeteries in Southern California, ooh. Including, of course.
What?
Naturally.
What? What?
The, you know, Hollywood, what is it? Beyond?
Oh, yeah. Well, of course it has to be on there.
Where they have concerts and movies, outdoor movies. I mean, is that a cemetery or is it like an extension of
would you go?
Studios?
Would you go? Would you go to a movie in the cemetery?
Oh, sure. Why not? Because, you know, I mean, when you're there, you see, look at the pictures. Huge crowds. Looks like thousands
yeah.
of people.
Yeah. I mean, come on. You know, they're honoring their dead in their own way.
I guess so. Oh. And I know there have been concerts there as well with, you know, fairly.
The Grateful Dead.
Peculiar. Well, that would certainly be appropriate. Yes, Hollywood Beyond is what we're talking about. I mean, I'm sorry. Hollywood Forever.
Hollywood Forever.
Cemetery, which yes. is half showbiz, half dead people.
Yes. Half and half.
Approximately.
Yes. Some headstones aren't even filled
yet. In Hollywood, probably 51% showbiz.
But, you know, fun fact about that particular cemetery, did you know that Penn and Teller, the magic duo, already have headstones there and they're not even buried yet?
No.
They do.
Why?
They do. I saw that on TV. They already have headstones there, and they're not even buried yet. Odd. Odd. I guess
sure,
they're...
They were given for free or something.
I don't know. I mean, they're... I was watching an episode of Penn and Teller Bull
BS. Beef,
yep. And that came up, Death in America, and of course, you know, I was watching that episode, and oddly enough, I mean, those... Their heart's in the right place, but sometimes I think they're a little far out there, Penn and Teller.
Yeah,
you know,
sure.
My opinion. I mean, they're good guys. I've interviewed both of them.
They're very yeah. cynical.
You're very cynical folk over there, but they already have headstones that allegedly talk to you as you walk by, though. Get out of here. Leave me alone.
I got to see that. I actually, we met them. We went to their show in sure. Las Vegas about maybe, I don't know, 5 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
And we met them after the show. Very nice, very yep. charming individuals, and had a great time. It was
cool.
Lots of fun. Sounds always a great show, man. You never know what they're going to do.
Nah, they're great. I've seen them live as well. In fact, Penn Jillette, I know him. He got his start right here in the great state of Minnesota.
Unbelievable.
At the Renaissance Fair. So, yes, I actually know him on somewhat of a personal level.
Very, very.
He's a tall dude, man.
He's tall a very dude. Tall guy. I think he's like 6'5".
Yeah, he's a big dude. Big dude.
One yeah, he was. He's not just tall. He's just he's big.
He's big,
you know,
man.
His head is huge.
Oh, yeah.
You know, his features are very large.
Yeah.
And then Teller's this is little teeny.
Yeah, he'd pound you into a grease spot. And then, you know. But, yeah, Teller is actually a very intelligent guy. He was a professor.
Extremely, so,
yeah,
obviously.
Yeah.
And he will talk to you.
Yes, he will. He will say, hey, what's up?
After the show, he will talk.
He just might.
No, he still will not talk during the show. All right, let's move along.
All right, let's get out of here. Let's go to something different.
A creature, a dead creature, you know, obviously, that they're calling a monster mummy.
A monster mummy. Unearthed.
Unearthed in a Siberian diamond mine. Take a look at that thing.
Man, did you ever hear, speaking about monsters and Siberia, did you ever hear, like, back in the late 90s where scientists allegedly drilled a hole in Siberia, like some 4 miles deep or whatever? Well, I can't remember the exact amount. I'm sure I'll be corrected. But they lowered a microphone down there and they could hear hell.
Oh, my goodness.
Did
really?
Did you ever hear that story? That's been around
I've
a while.
I've never heard that
yeah,
story.
Yeah. Allegedly now, you'd have to look it up. Some Siberian scientists went to the middle of Siberia, or Russian, rather, went to the middle of Siberia, drilled a hole, right? Like 4 miles deep, right? I think that what they're trying to do is get to the basically the inner crust of the earth, but they lowered this microphone to hear what the magma, you know, would sound like, and they heard people screaming. So it's like hell. They said hell's under us. Oh. Hell is here and it's right there. But
that is rather earth-shattering news.
It's happened back in the late 90s. Check it out. Hey, when you get a minute, Google Gate to Hell in Siberia.
Wow. And, well, that would mean that hell is physically bound.
Yeah. I would think so. I mean,
it means it's a real place within the earth.
Oh, boy.
Mind blown. All right, so you guys know. Let's move along now. So look at that thing. Anyway, so it does look creepy, but they're saying it's a Wolverine.
Oh, well, those are nasty anyway. I won't want to run into one in real life.
They are, but it sure looks creepier than that.
It does.
It's a long-dead mummified Wolverine. Hmm. Wow. All right, so tonight, this very evening, is when the Perseids... Is that how you pronounce it? I think it is. Or is it the Perseids? Anyway, the meteor shower that comes in August every year is supposed to be absolutely spectacular this evening. In fact, the Perseids or Perseids...
And well, however you want to say it. Tomato, tomato.
Please inform me, listeners, because I'm dumb. I mean, I see in writing, but I don't hear it said. They are to percolate precipitously tonight.
Big words, so fast, so close together.
I like alliteration.
You do. You're the big word man. You're the big word man. But no, that's very cool. It looks awesome. I like that picture. Everyone that's over there, Twitter with us, take a peek. It's very, very cool, and I just think it's very beautiful. In fact, that's something you could print out on one of those high-end printers and put on the wall.
I agree. I love it. I love that. The Milky Way and the dark sky.
Oh, yeah.
A meteor and snow-capped peaks. Oh, it is quite the image, my friends. Well worth joining Twitter.
Oh, yeah. Hey, I got a question.
AM haunted.
Got a question for you, sir.
Yes.
Now, I have seen this pasted here and there and, you know, everywhere else. What exactly is the ghost hunting day? I saw that posted. So why don't you fill the folks in that we can kind of get ready for the national ghost
hunting day? Well, my goodness. I actually was, I all of a sudden found myself, I'm not sure how it happened. I am the official PR guy.
You are?
For National Ghost Hunting Day. And that is coming October 1st.
Okay, I knew it was coming. That is awesome. October 1st.
Official day. Let me make it the registration, right? Within the official national calendar day, whatever, blah, 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 blah. It's the first Saturday of each October. But this year, that happens to be the first. And this will be the very first. So, yeah, we really encourage you to participate. If you have a team, if you are an investigator, or if you're simply interested in it, go to the website or to the Facebook or to the Twitter for that matter.
However you want to do it.
Go wherever you wish for National Ghost Hunting Day and register to participate. And the whole thing is, there's going to be all these satellite locations, hundreds, hopefully, all over. There's already dozens, but hopefully there will be hundreds all over the entire nation. And each of those, there'll be a very, very reasonable $10 donation. All of those will go to local animal shelters, humane societies, anything along those lines. You pick, you and your group pick. But you invite people to attend, and they can either participate in the hunt along with you or simply observe what you're doing with your team. But, yeah, this is the very first one, very exciting, the nerve center of all this, and there will be video. This will be live webcast.
Totally cool, man.
Worldwide. And the nerve center is at Scarefest, which is going on at that very same time, Scarefest down in Lexington, Kentucky. And it's really going to be an amazing thing. And a guy we had on the show very recently, Brian Cano.
Yeah.
He will be leading an experiment where they compile all the data from all of these different ghost hunts. And he is looking into the phenomena of collective consciousness.
Really? That's very, very cool. That's awesome. So that'll be National Ghost Hunting Day, everybody, October 1st. Make sure you come register with over at what was the website? Scarefest?
Well, you can get it through there. You can get it through our site, which is okay. America's Dash.
Well,
dash
you want to come to America's Dash.
Haunted. But to get directly to it, I will give you that URL if we hang on 1 second.
Yeah, here, yeah. Can I put you on the spot? Okay. Ding, ding.
Gotta click. All right. So here we go. So National Ghost Hunting Day. Just go to National Ghost Hunting Day.com.
NationalGhostHuntingDay.com, everybody. If you got a paranormal team, ghost hunters, you want to partake, now go out there, ghost hunt, and it's for a cause as well. $10 donation of your team will go to animal shelters and the like, and so it's a good thing. It's kind of like ghost hunting with a heart.
It really is, and it'll be very interesting to see what kind of collective data comes out of this thing. It's really pretty interesting. I'm looking forward to it. It's going to be a lot of fun, and hopefully we'll have literally thousands of people participating in this, not only nationwide, but worldwide as well. So how cool is that?
That is super, super cool. And
I think it is.
I think it's the first one, of course, and I think it'll become an annual event, and it'll be a good time. I may just have to go ahead and dust off the old investigative tools and get out there myself.
That would be wonderful, because we would love to have you on there. So what's going to happen is there will be a central feed, of course, for the live video, and we'll check in on all these various different locales throughout the country throughout the period. And it's short. It's only 2 hours, because we're trying to keep it really compressed and condensed.
Sure.
So it'll only be a brief visit for each, but of the first 100. If you're one of the first 100 groups to sign up, you're guaranteed that you will appear in the live video feed.
Very cool, man. Very, very cool. Bravo, man. Bravo for being the PR man
event. Fell in my lap. Who knows? Who knows how these
things happen? Heard worse things fall in my lap, like a rabid gopher.
Well, that would be far worse. Or that mummy Wolverine.
Yes.
That would be bad.
Hey, man, I had a squirrel in my house the other day. I'm not even kidding. It came in my house. And I felt
what, when they're indoors,
it's destructive.
Squirrels are big.
They are big.
They're not chipmunks.
The problem was I was on the telephone, and I looked up, and there it was staring at me. I mean, in my house, at the back of my couch, just staring at me.
Stopping.
And then the dog, you know, we have a chihuahua that weighs all 5 pounds, looked at it.
The squirrel was bigger.
He looked at it, went back to sleep. I'm looking at the squirrel.
I'm going to pretend I didn't see that.
Yeah, that's exactly what happened. Maybe I'm dreaming all this. Goes back to sleep. So I'm sitting there, right? I'm on the telephone, and it's important, fairly an important call. I can't freak out and go, oh, my God, there's a squirrel in my house. That would sound totally unprofessional. So, you know, I watch the squirrel, and then it starts chattering at me. You know that? Yes. It's sitting there, right? Looking at me with death in its eyes.
Wanted to feed him.
Yeah, exactly. And see, unfortunately, I have nut-bearing trees in my yard.
Nut-bearing trees, do you?
I do. They are butter.
Stand up for cable.
Good thing. I do believe they are like butternut trees, something like that, some type of nut. Well, anyhow, the squirrels, they love these things, and they're everywhere. Getting back to my story, I'm sitting there on the phone going, Look up, and there's the look of death all over its face. I mean, it's staring a hole through me, not like looking past me, but there it is. I made a move to get up and start chattering at me like, shut up, sit down. I'm the one that's in charge here. Oh, yeah.
Give me a nut. I'm just a squirrel.
I'm just a squirrel looking for a nut.
Maybe he was a blind squirrel, because, you know, even blind squirrels find a nut now.
Well, yes, that is true. Once in a while, blind squirrel will find a nut. That is true. But this one was nuts enough to come in my house with two cats.
And you realize that even a broken clock is right every 12 hours.
That is true. Every 12 hours. So, of course, we own two cats, and we've discussed before there. Do you think that any of these killing machines of cats are around? No. They're nowhere to be found. They're all upstairs sleeping. Right.
Not with a squirrel.
No. Exactly. They come down. Look at a squirrel. Go, oh, no, man. Not on my watch. And they take off.
Look at those teeth, man. He's got some choppers.
And so, of course, I felt like a full-on Griswold moment. you know, from the National Lampoon's Vacation. I'm thinking, uh-oh, I got a squirrel, and I can't hang up on who I'm with. It was a fairly important. And so then they ask, well, what's
Excuse
that?
Excuse me, squirrel emergency.
Exactly. I have a squirrel in my house. Hold on a minute, you know, and no, that just was not going to be an option. So I get up, and it starts chattering, and I knew it was go time. It was definitely go time after that. I finished my phone call. It let me finish my phone call. Like, well, 5 minutes more, my phone call. It let me do that. While it stared at me going,
chattering.
I'm going to kill you. You realize this, right? So I get off the phone. It starts chattering once again at me like it's going to murder me or something or rip my face off. So I got up calmly and I went to the other room of my home and got my son's BB gun.
Oh my.
Oh no, it didn't come to that. Don't worry. It didn't come to that. But I want to be armed, okay? If this thing was flying through the air at me like full blown ninja squirrel,
yeah, I don't blame you.
I wanted something at least to defend myself with.
Well, at least something to hit it.
Yeah, well, exactly. So I got this Daisy Red Rider BB gun that can't even puncture a pop can. What am I gonna do? You know? Like it's any match for a 5 pound squirrel. You know, it'd laugh at that BB. It'd go, ha, you think that could kill me?
It'd put it between its little fingers, little thumb and finger.
Yes, I'm the Chuck.
Kick it back at it.
It would. It'd shoot me my own BB. I'm the Chuck Norris of squirrels.
Put his eye out.
Well, so anyhow, I open the door. I get up, go open the front door, praying and hoping the squirrel will leave. You know, it's chattering. Meanwhile, it's chattering. The dog doesn't care. Cats don't care. I'm there alone to face pure, unadulterated terror. And there it is. And it comes.
Form.
And it decided to leave.
Oh, thank
you. No big crescendo. No big showdown. It just left.
All right. Who am I? Daddy, I want a squirrel.
Who are you?
It's either Violet or Veruca from Willy Wonka and the Chocolate Factory.
I want a squirrel.
I love the way English people say squirrel.
Squirrel. Give me a squirrel.
Syllable.
Give me a squirrel, Daddy.
Squirrel.
Give me a squirrel. Okay. Well, anyhow, I know I shot the headlines all to hell here.
That's all right.
Why don't you go ahead, though? We got a great guest tonight on tap, and I don't know if everyone knows who we're having, so why don't we kind of give him a teaser?
All right, I will tease you. Ha ha! You're
Where do you go with that one, Eric?
You're just a medium. You're not a small and you're not a large. You're a medium. Where did that come from? All right, we have medium, and that's the name he goes by these days, medium Armand Egidi. Hmm. And not only is that a cool, super cool name,
that is cool.
But he is a super cool guy. And we're going to be taking calls. We're going to be, he may, in fact, even be doing some readings over the air. We'll be taking emails. I guess there's already quite a few in there. And
there
he will
is.
Be telling us his tale. He's been a full-time practicing professional medium for 10 years now, but he's had the gift since he was 3. He has a vivid memory of when he was 3 years old.
Wow, man. That is awesome. So you want that. That's top of the next hour, of course. You're going to be able to talk to Armand yourself. Is that Armand or Armand?
I think it's Armand.
Okay, I was curious that name. How do they prefer to have that pronunciated? We will find out.
Armand.
My name is Armand. The cool name, though. Very, very cool name.
Very cool.
Oh, great response, by the way, from last week's episode, like always.
Nice.
Absolutely. We are currently sitting in the top. We are number one in our genre, by the way. And I just want to thank everyone that listens to the show and that has supported the show. And we have a new venue out there called Spreaker,
S-P-R-E-A-K.
And I have been lately putting archives up, what we have called After Hours AM Hits from the Vault. And that has been a great response. Wonderful response. A lot of new listeners coming to us because of the Spreaker. And that is, of course, sponsored and loved by iHeartMedia. So iHeartMedia, us, Spreaker, the whole thing. We're all in bed together, man. It's like one big audio. I won't go there.
It's a cluster.
It's a cluster.
Of love.
It's a cluster.
So, yeah, that's amazing. It really is cool. It's great to have all the outlets that we can get. We want to make it as easy as possible for people to hear the show. Yeah, it was an amazing show last week. We had our beloved Clarissa Cole for the whole first hour talking about the creepy ass Barbie and Ken. Oh my lord. They were horrifying.
That still messes with me, man. Even now.
Bernardo and Homolka. And boy, did they put the lie to the to the myth that Canadians are all cool and nice and benign polite.
Uh-huh.
They're not killing and raping people.
Well, yeah. Those particular Canadians, yes.
Oh, my Lord.
You know.
And then, of course, in addition, in the second hour, we had the one, the only, the legendary Eric Von Doniken.
That was a great show. And if you missed it, it's available both on Spreaker and Podomatic over there. Look it up, download it, listen to it, share it with your grandma, whoever. It was a great show. We got to run a break. We come back, we're going to read your emails, or I'm not going to. We're going to have Kirsten Klang, the beautiful and talented Kirsten Klang, is going to read your emails right after this. Don't go anywhere.
Something to do with your time. Something to do with your peace of mind. Something to do alone. Nothing to do, so won't you pick up the phone? You turn me on.
Anavar Media LLC is a dedicated team of professionals committed to helping business development scale and protect their websites, mobile applications, enterprise software solutions in the Northeast Ohio area. Locally owned since 2012, our client-centered values truly sets Anavar apart. Contact us today to learn how you can get 25% off your first project. Call them at 234-380-4852. Again, that's 234-380-4852. Or visit them at www.anavar.com. Again, that's www.anavar.com.
Hi, Tom Baudette. If you can hear me, then you have an internet connection, which means you can do cool things online, like listen to streaming radio, obviously, or watch a video of a monkey washing a cat. Let your freak flag fly. Or you can book a room at a great price at motel6.com. Isn't the internet wonderful? Everything you want right at your fingertips, and whoa, did not need to see that. I'm Tom Baudette for Motel 6, and we'll leave the light on for you.
Author Steve Asher brings us Hauntings of Trilogy. Steve's first book, Hauntings of the Kentucky State Penitentiary. This first installment of the trilogy tells us the tale of the Kentucky State Penitentiary and why it's so haunted. With every turn of the page will be something new and terrifying. Pick up Steve's new book, Hauntings of the Kentucky State Penitentiary, at Amazon.com, Barnes & Noble, and all better bookstores everywhere.
Are you hungry? Hungry as a gremlin? Here's gremlin cereal.
Gremlins, gremlins, bite after bite. What a tasty way to satisfy a gremlin appetite.
Gremlins is a deliciously sweet, crunchy cereal that satisfies the hungry little gremlin that's in all of us.
Gremlins, gremlins, bite after bite. What a tasty way to satisfy a gremlin appetite.
Gremlins cereal is part of this complete breakfast.
Gremlin, yum yum.
If you're listening to After Hours AM, do you have a question for the guests or even the host? That's really easy. Go ahead and email those questions to afterhoursam@gmail.com. Are you feeling like picking up the phone and being part of the show? Call us at 612-326-6874, 612-326-6874. Come be part of the madness.
This is the latest disclosure in a report from National Civil Defense Headquarters in Washington. It has been established that persons who have recently died have been returning to life and committing acts of murder. A widespread investigation of reports from funeral homes, morgues, and hospitals has concluded that the unburied dead are coming back to life and seeking human victims.
My head so high in the clouds.
And welcome back to After Hours AM, everybody. I am your host, Joel Sturgis. Right along with me is
Eric Olsen.
Eric, the National Ghost Hunting Day man. Olsen.
That's me.
That's you, the spokesman. But we have.
I am.
It's time, Eric. Time to do what? It's time.
It's time for a visit.
Yes, and now.
Our very own sweetheart of the great northern woods, Kirsten Klang.
And not a lot of people don't know this, but Kirsten is a former hand model in the Soviet Union. So. No, but.
What a small world.
These are your emails read live by the beautiful and talented Mystical Minnesota's own Kirsten Klang. Kirsten, what's in the old hopper this week to terrify us?
I have stuff that will chill you to the bone.
To the bone.
You're very welcome on a balmy August.
It'll knock a buzzard off a poop wagon.
Yeah, it should give you a little chill here. So if your AC isn't working, this is where you want to be tonight. Stay tuned through the whole thing. We've got some great stuff. Unbelievable. Really wonderful stories and well written, too. Thanks, guys. Keep them coming. I start off right now with Steve Asher, our own Steve.
Steve!
Kentucky resident and author of Hauntings of the Kentucky State Penitentiary. And Steve had one in for last week, and I'm following this through because I couldn't get it in last week. And I just wanted this one. This one's creepy. Got creepy dolls.
Oh, creepy dolls.
Oh, yeah.
You I love a good dolls. Creepy doll.
Well, let's start out with my older sister kept me as a kid a lot as my mom and dad worked. I sometimes, with my brother, who was 4 years older, would sleep over. My sister had one of those long shelves that went nearly the length of the wall, about 6 feet above my bed. My brother and I slept in there. We both never liked the room at all. One night, we kept hearing something odd, as if it was in the ceiling. We both looked up and only saw the doll. It just stared ahead towards the foot of the bed. My brother said, it must be a squirrel or something.
It's all not a squirrel. They're dangerous.
Yeah. Just roll over. Go to sleep. Well, sometime in the night, I'd say about 2:30, maybe 3 a.m., we started hearing the sound again. But it sounded different. More like a dragging. We had a small little hand flashlight, but it was pretty small, and I was scared of the dark a little bit. My brother said, just ignore it. It's just whatever.
Just ignore it. Don't worry. It won't kill you.
I'll help brothers explain that.
Oh, sure.
Probably my brother. I tried the light, and it would work for a little while, but then it would shut off. I lay there checking the battery, but it wouldn't work. It just wouldn't come on. Then I hit the back of it, finally got it to come on. I shined the light ahead of me, and I didn't see anything. Shot across the corners of the ceiling, I didn't see anything. Finally, ended up shining it right above my head on a little doll. I will never forget it. The doll had a lilac purple long dress, kind of Civil War style. It was really old, a little antebellum, a little parasol. It had been looking ahead, then suddenly it was looking down at me. Then it moved its umbrella from where it was above its head and pointed it towards me. It was one of the scary damn things, said Steve, and he will not allow dolls like that in his house to this day. He will totally leave them in the shed.
Oh, no, I don't like dolls either. No. Dolls and me just don't get along, especially the realistic porcelain-looking ones. No! Keep those things away from me!
Just the silicone ones?
No, well, yeah, because I got this...
I would say the determining factor is when they move of their own accord,
Yes. Yes, if they are free moving and totally, you know, can think for themselves, especially about murder, I really don't want them around me. I have seen Child's Play, and I know how it ends, and it ends badly.
You know, I was thinking...
Alive was creepy.
You know, who we should introduce to that doll?
Who...
Your squirrel.
Chattering at me, screaming, yelling, terrifying me. And
Daddy, I want a squirrel.
Daddy, give me the squirrel. Give me the squirrel now.
All right, we've interrupted enough.
Yes, we have.
All right, we got one.
The sweetheart of the great northern woods.
Former hand model.
Well, we have one from Laura this week. A sweetheart from Yorkshire, England.
Oh.
She says, hey, Joel, love the show. And we love it here in the UK. Make sure to tell the gang over there hi from us. And here's my story.
Okay. Well, hi from her, guys.
Yeah.
Thank you for passing that word on.
Yeah, that's sweet. I had grown up living in the same house for me, being about approximately 18 months old to 15 years old. I had always had a tiny box room, and my older brother had the larger room, my mom and dad in the middle room. When we moved house, I was 15 years old, our new house was a dormer bungalow and one downstairs bedroom and two upstairs bedrooms. My parents said it was because I was always in the box room. I could have my pick of the upstairs bedroom. Being the youngest, they didn't want me downstairs alone. So I obviously picked the biggest bedroom, which looked out onto a huge farm.
Sure.
My brother had the room next door. We moved on in a Friday in November, and me and mom spent the Saturday putting up ornaments, pictures, etc. in place. Mm-hmm. A huge part of the story which will unfold is that my mom had one brother and
my
his
mom.
Wife, Auntie B, did not have children, but she really wanted them.
She stole one. Sorry.
Yeah, she really did. Well, it's kind of sad, actually. This part's a little sad, but yeah, you'll figure it out.
Okay.
When my mother had my brother, Auntie B, found it hard to accept. When mom had me, it made things worse, because my auntie's perfect family would have been a boy and a younger girl. My auntie was then brutally murdered in another country when I was 18 months old. As my mom put up some really old pictures in our new house of cows standing in a field, I said to her, "Mom, they're awful. Don't put them up in the new house." Her reply was, "Auntie Dee bought them. Don't say that. What's wrong with them?" As she said that, both pictures flew across the room going nowhere towards the television, but the television turned off and they never got to work again.
Wow.
Mom kind of brushed the whole thing under the carpet and said it was nothing.
That's totally normal, kids. Don't look this way.
Don't mind the scary.
No matter. Don't worry about it.
But it scared me half to death.
Quite
a long time after this, I was in my bed. Because the room was so big, I had two single beds and a bedside chest in between with a lamp on it. I was reading a book. It looked like a man in a raincoat standing in the field staring into my bedroom. It didn't bother me too much as my big brother was next door and my dad was sleeping right below me. But after an hour or so of reading, I decided to get out of bed and check. As I opened my bedroom window to take a proper look, I quickly realized it was a horse facing my way. But at the same time, I heard a scream, not from outside, but as if someone was standing right next to me, screaming like they were being murdered. I jumped into my bed, convinced that any second my brother and dad would come find me to see what the scream was. I reached for the lamp at the bedside chest. Although it was dark, it was nowhere near pitch black, so I could see. Every time my hand got within inches of the lamp, it moved away from me.
Wow.
I was in total panic at this point.
I'd be leaving.
Wondering where my brother and dad were.
Don't you want a pair of shoes?
In? What? Where are they? Goofing off somewhere.
Goofing off. They're goofing. Maybe they're fighting other demonic forces somewhere. You know. Who knows?
Well, that's possible. The walls were paper thin in their house, and you could hear everything through them, so why didn't they come? I was so scared I couldn't shout for them or even go find them. I just laid in bed hoping they would come. Then, as if someone was standing at the foot of my bed, my covers were being pulled.
Oh, no.
I had to pull them up as hard as I could to keep myself covered.
I live in fear of that.
Both hands.
Mm.
Look at both hands.
Wow. I live in fear of that happening to me.
So I gave up trying to get to the lamp. The main light switch was at the other side of the bedroom, and nothing would have gotten me out of that bed. Eventually, the covers were still, and I went to sleep. I told my parents and brother what happened. They never heard anything at all and said I must have been dreaming, but I hadn't even gone to sleep yet that night. After that, I slept on the sofa for about 2 months and never went in that room alone until eventually Dad swapped mine and brother's room.
Wow.
Then, years later, I was about 22, I went to see a clairvoyant, and as soon as I got there, she said, "You want answers. Someone has done something to you and you want to know why and who." I immediately knew she was talking about that night. Later, clairvoyant said, "There's a lady here named Dee. She's laughing and saying, I pulled the covers and I moved the lamp, but I won't bother you anymore. I can't anymore." Does this make sense to you?
No, it makes no sense to me.
Run screaming. No, but she said yes. It was then she was told that her grandparents had died when she was 21. Well, very strong spirits, and because she was so afraid of spirits, her grandparents would not ever let a spirit get through to her. That's what she believed that Dee meant by what she said, I won't bother you anymore. I can't.
Oh, well, yeah, no one could bother them in the first place, but I bet you a squirrel would have made her come out of that bed. Sorry.
Well, she's now 25. She keeps the lamp on every night, and she just recently moved out of the home. She had slept with a giant poodle until her moved out and now lives with her partner, and she still to sleep in the dark.
That's the exact.
Sleep, but can't sleep in the dark.
That's the exact attack dog I would choose too for the demonic. A giant poodle.
A giant poodle.
Walk
bring on
right.
The giant poodles. Speaking of giant poodles, that is so funny. That's a great story. Is it over?
Is it over?
That was by the way, scary.
That. By the way, that was.
Go ahead. Finish your thought.
Anyway. I looked out, I think I've stayed at some point, my office, and the, what am I hearing about nuts and nutrition and whatnot? Oh, squirrels, get it. Yes. All right, so anyway, I look out the window of my office, which is up above the garage, so it's second story, and there's an enormous poodle running around in my yard. And then it runs off into the street, which is a very busy street with a 45-mile-an-hour speed limit.
Wow.
I think, oh, no, there's going to be a squished poodle in front of my house, and this will cause quite a mess.
Yeah,
I'm
would.
Not happy about that. Nor will probably the owners be. So well, I run outside. Poodle, don't get squished.
Just now you did this?
No, this was
okay. Okay, I was gonna say what?
You are yesterday. Okay. No, it was yesterday.
Okay, okay.
So there's giant poodles in the news and in my mind. So I chased it back off the road, and fortunately, it was not squished.
Well, that is good. That's
heroic
a very
of you, Eric. Yes.
I have no idea who owns this giant black poodle.
Wow. Maybe
wow.
Was
running around willy nilly.
Maybe it's a harbinger of death.
It might have been
Satan's poodle.
That's right, Satan's nasty poodle.
Death rides a black poodle.
You know, little known fact: the hounds of hell are going to be poodles.
And just quaffed.
That's right.
She was well maintained
with the pom poms on the rear end.
All that nonsense. All that poodle
oh,
stuff.
Oh, poodle!
All right, so I'll be quiet.
All right, I have another one from Kirsten. Kirsten has one from Kirsten.
All right, cool.
Barnesville, Ohio. Hi, Kirsten. I'm Kirsten. I just love that. I have an unusual name, and we never get. To
I'm in Ohio.
You are in Ohio.
It doesn't happen. I enjoy it every time it happens.
Oh, well, once
in a while. Anyways, Kirsten says, love the show, guys. Love how you've been including hits from After Hours AM Vault over Spreaker.
Spreaker.
I love you guys.
Spreaker. But yes, thank
Spreaker
you for listening.
Spreaker.
Yes, thank you for listening. Thank you for taking notice.
Potato. All right. Yeah. Before my family ever lived around here, there was a father.
She lived somewhere else.
We had a different
once
house.
Upon a time, she was pregnant with a son.
No.
After she had her baby, they decided they didn't want him. They didn't take him to another family, to an orphanage. Instead, they threw him down the well.
What?
Yeah, they threw him down the well. God.
This is very
poor. Once upon a time. Yeah, what's the time?
This is irresponsible.
That is very. Yeah. We don't want you anymore, so get down the well you go. Splash.
The neighborhood association says.
Oh, they frown on that. Baby chucking.
We're writing you a strongly worded letter.
Baby chucking is frowned upon around these parts.
Especially in the well. You're
going to clog that up.
Years later, when my grandfather moved into the house, he would hear strange cries coming from the house. He would look and find nothing. Later on down the road, his son, which would be my father, moved into the house with his wife. He would later have a daughter and a son. Our father would tell us about the baby every day. It would amaze us. One day, my parents were outside working in the barn. We were in the house. I decided to do downstairs to play Xbox. After a while, we went to go back upstairs, but we couldn't. The door was locked. There was no one else in the house but my brother and I. Then, the lights turned off. We both thought it was our dad because he likes to mess around.
Mm-hmm.
We emboldened to open the door and let us use it.
Mm-hmm.
No one would answer. We kept pounding on the door trying to get someone's attention. Then we heard it. It was the cry of the baby.
Uh-oh.
I never heard such an awful cry before. Your hair is on the back of your
neck. Oh, I've heard it because, you know, I have a baby at home, and when they decide to get mad at you, there's a cry, unlike a baby's cry.
Oh, God. That sent shudders down my spine. After we heard that, we went to another door trying to find our parents. They were in the barn the whole time. They had no idea what we were talking about.
Rolling in the hay.
We have never heard that cry again. The baby got it, I guess, got its message through something.
So the baby cried one time to freak you out, and then it never happened again. You walk in the barn, there's your parents rolling around saying, "Get out of here, Mikey! Or Kirsten, get out of here."
Yeah.
Take a walk.
At least it didn't come clambering out of the
water. Well, wouldn't that have been horrible?
Oh,
jeez. Then you'd have to burp it and everything? No, I'm good.
Oh, poor baby.
I know, right? Don't be throwing babies down. Oh. That's the moral of the story. Don't throw babies down wells.
Sorry, that one was a downer. You guys want to hear one? This one's kind of funny.
Yes. Yes, give us something funny now.
That was scary.
That was.
I know.
That almost made me cry. My one feeling almost got hurt.
Tearing a little bleak, yeah.
Oh.
Anyway, this one's from Abhi. Abhi in Kerala, India. Hi, Joel.
Hey.
It's great how you started including listeners' encounters, and Kirsten is reading them really well. Thank you, Abhi. Yay for us girls in the paranormal. Here's my story. I know Kirsten will find interest in this one. Well, she was right, and I did.
Did you? Okay.
Yes, I did. My semester exams were over. I was in festival mood after undergoing a month of intellectual torment and strain. I love how she said that. That's so true, isn't it?
It is true. Oh. I don't know. I partied my way through college.
Oh,
I majored in beer and girls.
My friend, let's call him Mr. M. We decided to party and booze for the rest of the day and night. We got a crate of beer and a couple of bottles of local whiskey, settled down at my friend's house. We made merry and drank to our heart's content. Clock struck 12, we thought it was now the right time to go out for dinner. We pumped up the old Yamaha motorbike and we were off. The main road was 68 miles away. We had to travel through a vast, lonely stretch of road between the local woods.
Man.
Covered with thick vegetation on both sides, the trees that looked like they were stretched all the way to the heavens. We had almost covered half the way when our bike slowed down and finally came to a standstill. I understood that fuel level was nearly empty.
Uh-oh.
Now there was an eerie silence that surrounded us. Not impressed with the sort of atmosphere, I rushed to my friend who was putting in his best efforts to get the bike started and up and running again. Still, we were within a walkable distance of the main road. To my dismay, his efforts proved in vain. Thus, pushing the bike, we started walking. I cursed myself for having intoxicated myself
to
such an extent that my common sense and logic disappeared.
Oh, yes.
Forcing me to make idiotic decisions. Oh. Haven't we all been there, kids?
It's a hard knocks life.
Pretty much part of life here. We were almost at the gates of a local church when my friend explained his uncontrollable urge to pee. While he was engaged in the process, I took a liberty.
I like the way she writes. Hold on. Engaged in the process of peeing. So proper. Like it's some procedure he's doing. Like brain surgery. The guy stops the side of the road, takes a leak. He's engaged in urination.
While engaged in the process, I took the liberty of peeping into the cemetery behind the church. I could clearly see marked graves with humongous pieces of stones. Some of them were relatively fresh, glittering in the moonlight. Just as I gazed down to one of the clearly visible tombstones, I read an inscription on the tombstone which read, "For I shall return."
Oh.
This statement mildly sent a chill down my spine. Diverting my attention from this, I called out to my friend. But to my horror, I found him unconscious. Gathering my cool, I sprinkled some water on his face from the bottle carried on the bike.
Mm-hmm.
Upon gaining consciousness, my friend told me of a semi-deformed face which looked at him right in the eye while he was peeing.
Wow. Right in the eye while he was in the process of doing this very, very hard maneuver called peeing.
I,
in the process of.
Which eye did he look in?
Yeah.
Poor guy.
So he's right sitting off, there. Right? Yeah, I mean, I would think that would clamp that baby right down, and I'm out of there, man. I don't know. I might have to pee, but, you know, I got to go. Sorry. Show's over. Wow.
Poor guy. He falls in it. Oh,
sitting there,
sorry.
You know, mind his own business. Probably whistling.
The bike, she'd have to ride with Mr. Peeing.
Yeah, probably whistling to Andy Griffith's tune while he's peeing. Or singing Swing Low, Sweet Chin, while he's peeing, you know, or whatever. And next thing you know, he's looking face to face with a ghost of pure evil. Decided to come back while he was in midstream of urination. And he says, the ghost says, hey man, you might want to go to the doctor and get that prostate checked out. That flow is not too strong. Just saying.
You know, flow max on that. Yeah.
Yeah, you might want to take care of that. So yeah, that.
Barry, one more if you guys want to hear it.
Well, we got 5 minutes left. And if you think you can whip one out in five minutes.
Yep, I do. This one's a fairly short one. This one's from Paul in Newell, Texas. Says, hey guys, great job on the show, and thanks for taking time to read my story. Been freaking out for a long time. Maybe Joel or someone can give their thought. I've had many experiences with a supernatural sort, but I must tell you the most horrible experience ever. As a child, my brothers and sisters had always been in trouble for things that none of us had done. Something would be missing or moved, and when our parents asked, none of us knew what had happened. We had all counseled each other after our parents went away to admit who had really done it. A lot of times, it was none of us. Eventually, after hearing a lifetime of noises, feeling like someone was watching us and being terrified at night, got used to it. Accepted that there was ghosts that liked to get us in trouble. I think the spirit first came to us in Birmingham, Alabama. We moved many times. It seemed like it followed us all over Alabama and Texas. It did take a while to catch up every time we moved, especially from Alabama to Texas.
Mm-hmm.
When I was 15, I moved to Niederwald, Texas. My older siblings had moved out on their own by then. I was with my parents, myself, and my brother. Things began to happen right away. Items being moved around, noises, terrifying nights full of that I'm watching you feeling.
Uh-oh.
One
I'm
night, I was awakened by something
every
unknown, but I was too afraid to get up. My bed began to shake. When I did open my eyes, I saw three witches, hags, whatever you want to call them. They circled around my bed at the ceiling of my room. They were either one entity split into three or triplets, identical and sinister. They circled me laughing and chanting over and over again, mine, you're mine.
Oh my God.
I finally yelled at them to go away and I ran to my parents' room. My parents let me sleep on their floor, gave me my the family Bible for comfort. They didn't
get out
say
here.
Whether or not they believed me.
Go away. Here's a Bible. Leave us alone.
Sleep on the floor.
Great parents.
Right. When we got up in the morning, I felt very foolish. I was trying to convince myself of things like this in my imagination. I apologized to my parents for disturbing their sleep and described in detail what had happened. Nobody really said anything. I think they thought I was ill or something.
Well, go ahead. Sorry.
Sorry,
no, just wow. Hey, mom and dad, there's demons in my room. Here's a Bible. Go in there and face the demonic on your own, buddy. Okay, we're trying to sleep.
Like they were worried. Then they could, you know, they were worried about them. Not really convinced that anything supernatural had occurred. When my dad was leaving the house to go to work that day, he yelled for us to come look. There was a 10-inch wooden cross nailed to the wall right by the front door.
Hmm.
The nail was tacked to the top of the cross. The cross was upside down on the nail. It had rotated on its own.
No.
We don't question these experiences anymore.
Well, I wouldn't either after that, to be honest with you. I would just leave it alone.
Yeah?
I'm surprised you're even telling the tale for everyone to hear.
Whoa.
To be honest with you.
Oh, my heavens. Oh,
wow, that would freak me out. My gosh.
Really?
I don't think I'd be in the house anymore. I wouldn't go in there by myself with a Bible. Here, kid, take a Bible. No, I'm good.
I would use that Bible to pound that nail into the wall better.
Yeah, I would, yes. It's really a question of home maintenance, kids.
Too loose.
Guys usually like three chicks fighting over them. But
well, not those three chicks. No, I'm good. I'm good. Yeah, no. Well, Kirsten, you know, tell everyone what's going on over at Mystical Minnesota, of course. And I'll get a hold of you and all that kind of good stuff before we have Medium Armand Egidi come on the show, and we're going to talk medium stuff and do some readings, have a good time with him. But before that, tell us how people can get a hold of you and what's on the horizon for Mystical Minnesota.
Come on over to see us on Facebook at Mystical Minnesota on Facebook. Also, Mystical Minnesota at Mystical, M-I-N-N, like Minnesota, at Twitter. And you can find us there.
Yeah, check it out. A lot of cool new pictures.
And oh, all the time.
Be a part of it.
It's hard, kids.
All right. Well, thank you, Kirsten, for knocking it out of the park. But when we come back, everybody, medium Armand Egidi. When we come back, you're not going to want to miss that. And maybe you'll just learn a little bit more about mediumship. Don't go anywhere right after this.
News Radio, I'm Kathleen Maloney. Another drop in the polls for the GOP presidential candidate. Fox's Grinnell Scott joins us live.
Kathleen, the new Fox News Latino poll shows Donald Trump's support is falling among Hispanic voters. Only 20% support him now. While Democrat Hillary Clinton's favorable support remains stable, Trump's unfavorables are up over 3 months from 74% to 82%. Drilling down even further, Puerto Rican voters are abandoning Trump in droves, 12% for, 85% against. That, according to the poll, is key in Florida, a traditionally red state where the Puerto Rican population has more than doubled since 2002, Kathleen.
Thanks, Grinnell. Hillary Clinton rolled out her plan to create jobs and improve the economy.
I believe that every employee from the CEO suite to the factory floor contributes to a business's success. So everybody should share in the rewards.
The Democratic presidential candidate also knocking her opponent's economic plan as ineffective for working families.
With his own addition of outlandish Trumpian ideas that even Republicans reject.
Clinton speaking in Warren, Michigan. GOP vice presidential nominee Mike Pence accuses the media of treating his running mate unfairly.
The media is so busy lying about Donald Trump, it's like they don't have time to tell the truth about Hillary Clinton.
The Indiana governor at a town hall in Wisconsin. Olympic results for the women's gymnastics. 19-year-old Simone Biles of the U.S. wins gold for the all-around. Teammate Ali Raisman takes the silver, Russia getting the bronze. A rally on Wall Street, the Dow climbing 118 points, S&P gaining 10, NASDAQ up 24. Fox News Radio, fair and balanced.
Psst, yeah, you, it's me, your heart. Listen to me, we've got to talk. High blood pressure is serious, and yours? Whoa, what happened to us? We used to be so much more active. But lately, you've been ignoring me. I know you think I'm just going to keep ticking away forever, but you're wrong. You can do so much more to control your high blood pressure. Doing the minimum isn't doing enough. I'm under a lot of pressure and can quit whenever I want. Bet you didn't know that. But I like my job. Just treat me better. Check on me. Give me something green to nibble on every once in a while. And maybe we can do some exercise on occasion. Let's get to it. After all, we're in this together.
Listen to your heart. Don't let it quit on you. High blood pressure can lead to a stroke, heart attack, or death. Get your blood pressure to a healthy range before it's too late. Find out how at heart.org/bloodpressure. Check, change, control. A message from the American Heart Association, the American Stroke Association, and the Ad Council.
Authorities prevent a terror attack.
Canadian authorities say they were in a race against time to stop 24-year-old ISIS supporter Aaron Driver from detonating a bomb, possibly causing mass casualties. Driver was killed Wednesday following a confrontation with law enforcement. The Royal Canadian Mounted Police say they were tipped off about the plot by the FBI. The U.S. agency obtained a video of a masked man threatening an attack. The suspect was soon identified as Driver, who authorities say was a known ISIS supporter. Outside an Ontario home where he was staying, cops opened fire as Driver tried to pull away in a taxi. Authorities say he detonated an explosive device. Still unknown, Driver's intended target. Police say they believe it was a major population center. In New York, David Lee Miller, Fox News.
A boy is in the hospital after getting hurt while riding a wooden roller coaster at the Idlewild and Soak Zone Park in Pennsylvania. The lead in a popular TV series is sidelined for bad behavior.
Criminal Minds actor Thomas Gibson is on the sidelines for now and is responding to being benched following an on-set altercation. According to The Hollywood Reporter, the actor, who has been with the CBS procedural since its start, has been suspended for 2 episodes. Gibson responded by saying there were creative differences on the set and a disagreement. Now, Gibson was directing and got into it on set with the writer. The dispute got heated, and Gibson is said to have reacted to aggression and kicked the writer. This is the second incident for Gibson. He pushed a producer a few years ago and had to attend anger management classes. Michelle Polino, Fox News.
President Obama's playing a lot of golf during his vacation on Martha's Vineyard, and he could put together a strong pickup basketball team with his golfing partners. They include Chris Paul of the L.A. Clippers, Golden State Warriors Stephen Curry, and former All-Stars Alonzo Mourning and Ray Allen. I'm Kathleen Maloney, Fox News Radio.
And welcome back to After Hours AM, everybody. I'm your host, Joel Sturgis, right along with me,
Eric Olsen.
Hey, Eric, man. Great job, by the way. I want to tell Kirsten on air here, great job reading the listener emails, and also great job sending the emails. Wow, we ever had a reaction to that. It's been a great reaction of
really
all the people that want to have their emails read live on air. I just want to thank everyone again for making After Hours AM, the number one show. But it's kind out there right now. And so
Kirsten has that soothing, maternal voice.
I love everybody.
And she is the sweetheart of the Great Northern Woods.
She is. And a former hand model in Russia. Don't worry. No,
we never leave that out or I'll be mad.
Well, anyhow, Eric, we have a blockbuster guest joining us tonight. So why don't you go ahead and enlighten the audience?
We do, and I am quoting, "Where there is darkness, I bring light. Where there is misunderstanding, I bring clarity. To say that I love what I do would be an understatement. I am a psychic medium and spiritual teacher driven in this life to bring forth awareness and healing through love and connection to the spiritual world," says medium Armand Egidi. For 10 years, Egidi has utilized his psychic gifts to help others heal emotional wounds and face their deepest fears. Not only does he work with those in spiritual need in his New Jersey base, but he travels regularly around the country and across the globe from Sydney to Sao Paulo. As of this writing, Armand has spread his light in 6 countries, traveled over 78,000 miles, and helped nearly 3,000 people. Welcome to the program, Armand Egidi.
Thank you so much. I thank both of you for having me on.
Hey, not a problem.
Really look forward to this.
You get around, my friend. You got some miles on you.
Yeah, I do. I just got back on Monday from Los Angeles, where I was reading people there for 2 weeks, actually, in L.A., Beverly Hills, Malibu, all around the whole area. I just loved every minute of it.
Cool, man. I mean, I was watching, of course, we get ready for the show all the time, and we've had a lot of mediums on. I mean, we've had, you know, the tops of the tops, the up and come. The way you deliver, though, when you talk to somebody, is so genuine. That's something that struck me. It really comes from the heart. You know, a lot, some of these psychics, I love them all. I'm friends, like, with a lot of psychics that have been on the show, very close friends. But you have a delivery that when you're talking to him, you can just tell it's coming from, I don't know if that's lost. Eric, did you notice that too? When he's talking to somebody, it's just coming from the heart, man. And that is so, I think that's really a skill. That's a really good skill to have, because it's more of a counseling time as well. I mean, because it's so shocking for a lot of the people when they're first having a reading. It might be their first reading ever. And you're giving them this reading that might even be earth-shattering. Do you find yourself, where does that come from? Does that all come from spirit, or is that you counseling them as well?
It's a little bit, thank you very much for the compliments that you gave me as well. I very much appreciate it. And in a very humble way, I thank you for it. It comes from both. I would say that the energy that's flowing through me from spirit comes through to me, and that love and that energy that's passing through me gets passed to the client that I'm reading. Mm-hmm. And in addition to that, you know, when I always say this, that I love what I do, because I, you know, that saying, I, you know, darkness withers light, you know, understanding, that really is so much me, because the messages that I bring through make a connection. And I take what I do very seriously, because it is a responsibility. Mm-hmm. This is not a carnival act. This isn't a, smoke and mirrors. This is real. And people will hear my voice. And if any of you guys have been read before, you hear the medium's voice for hours, days, weeks, and months after that.
Sure.
The messages brought through are very, the delivery and the meaningfulness and the content, all of that is all very, very vital. And it's very personal when I mm-hmm. read somebody too.
Yeah. Very, very, very cool stuff. Very interesting stuff. I got to back up. I got to back the truck up here for a minute.
Sure.
And I got to ask you, when did you become self-aware that you had this ability?
Well, I can. Do you want me to give you the first ever time where, like, kind of the ignition of this started?
If you'd like, sure, you can keep it in a nutshell, because I'm sure there's a lot to it, because you just don't wake up one morning and go, hey, I'm psychic, by the way, everybody.
Well, this kind of runs in the family, and I started, like, the first time that it was recognized in me, I was 2.5 years old, and I was at the foot of my mom's bed. She was pregnant with my brother, and she recounted that I stood up, looked over the bed, and said, you know, in my two-and-a-half-year-old voice, you know, that wasn't nice. And she said, what wasn't nice? I said, you told me to stop playing with my damn trucks and cars and go in the other room. And her mouth hung open, and she said, I never said it. I only thought it. And if there's an acceleration from that point of just knowing, as I mm-hmm. call it, through mm-hmm. grammar school and in a little bit into high school, of just knowing. It wasn't until the age of 25 that I was sitting in my at work, and there was a person that said to me, Armand, do you know what you're doing? And I was like, no, what am I doing? He goes, you're reading me. You're telling me stuff that I have never told you. And that was the first time that I really was like, yeah, I guess I'm able to reach in and do that. Because I just did it as a norm. I thought it was just what I do, you know.
Sure. Now, did it shock you when someone else came up to you like that and said, hey, man, you're reading me? Or was it, you know, kind of like shocking to you as well? Like, oh, my gosh, totally discovering that you have this ability.
I think it kind of merged. His words merged with what I always kind of knew. But it validated it. And I was like, I guess so. I mean, I had done this in the past, but I always kept kind of quiet about it, because I didn't want to shock somebody, or I didn't know how they would receive it. And mm-hmm. this was the first time. He goes, go ahead, keep going. And I kept on reading him, and it was just an amazing reading.
Mm-hmm. Now, when you read somebody, do you almost need permission to read them? Because, I mean, I've seen those shows where they're like, you're doing a cold out on the street. I mean, they're walking around literally. Hey. Grandpa Bubba says hi, by the way. I mean, is there like some type of, do you almost have to like cooperate with the reading?
Yeah, absolutely. You know, and I run a group that I run called The Knowing, where I help others to develop their skills and ability. And we were just going over that tonight in group. You know, that there's a ritual kind, not a ritual, because that sounds like a ritual, but there's steps that you do. Because for me, I never walk up to somebody on the streets and do that to them. To me, it's trespassing. To mm-hmm. me, it makes it sort of like, see what I can do.
Yeah.
And more so, I sit down with somebody and I ask them if I have permission to talk to the energies behind them. Do you give them permission to talk with me? And I sit down, because this is a very intimate moment, and intimacy stands for into me, you see. Them allowing me into their world, into their space, and into the energies behind them is very precious. You know, it's very personal to them, and I take it seriously.
Now, on a personal level,
yeah,
as a medium, and as a responsible medium, I might add, do you ever feel that programming or people doing that, do you think it kind of cheapens your abilities, almost makes it into that sideshow circus act?
I think what it does is it there are people that want to see things in a fast way, like show me you can do it. And the public, you know, they're very intrigued by it. They want to see it happen before their eyes. And I think in the media, they are given that particular format. You know, here it is. We won't let you wade through an hour of a reading. We'll allow you to see it, you know, quickly. And because we're a very immediate society.
Yeah.
We're very quick. We want to see it.
Sure.
And I think in some ways it may, in fact, I think it's helped in some ways because it gives it and it clears things up and it shows people that there is another side. So I don't think it's horrific that it happens at all. In fact, I think it's helped. But, you know, when I sit down with a person, it's done in a way where that person has an hour of my time and their time and the spirit's time in order to create this exchange.
Very, very cool. Very, very interesting. And do you ever get overload, though? I mean, do you ever get what they call psychic overload, where the spirits just don't seem to want to leave you alone? Or you have to tell them, hey, leave me alone. It's private time.
No, you know, that's a really, really great question, because I am grateful to say that I can turn this on and shut it off. And that I've been able to develop this way of when I'm off, I'm off. And when I'm on, it's by a lack of better words, arousal. So when somebody wants to get a reading and they, you know, I've sit down with them, the wheel starts turning. This sense of, okay, I'm here to do this work with them and to gain the information from the other side to give to them. And that's what we're going to do. And it then the wheel starts turning of me going into that zone, if you will, or getting into that highway of information. But normally, no, I'm off.
Okay. So there is, you're able to kind of turn on the, I mean, you've honed that skill, because obviously that was a skill that had to be honed. You just didn't realize, hey, I can flip it on, flip it off. As you progressed in your life and you've been a medium and in your young life, was there ever like a dark time in your life that just reaffirmed your faith in God and how he speaks through you? I mean, was there ever a time where he stopped and said, you know what, you need to stop what you're doing and listen?
Yeah, I'll tell you this outright. I'm very open about this. I'm in recovery for 26 years from alcohol and drugs. And I started out in seventh and eighth grade, starting to use pot and alcohol, and it progressed. And I call those the dark times between seventh, eighth grade in that arena, and till the age of 25. And just before me getting sober, I actually hung myself.
Literally
hung myself.
Oh, boy.
It was on a Friday. It was in a field office for a gas company I was working for in between college, you know, during the summertime. And I wasn't high. I wasn't drunk. I wasn't anything like that. I had just had it. And I strung myself up. And if I had kicked the stool to the other side of the room, I would not be here speaking to you. And there was something after I hung there for what felt like an hour. I mean, it felt like a long time, but it, you know, in all reality, it was probably like a minute, you know, a minute and a half.
Sure.
And I was going numb. I was getting pins and needles, like all around my lips and my face. I can feel it happening. Mm-hmm. And there was not a voice or anything like that that happened. It was just this feeling that I got inside, and I said, I don't want to do this. And I grabbed with my right foot the stool and was able to stand up and get the noose out from my neck, but I was very weak in doing it. It was this moment of sanity, this moment of realizing that I a feeling so worthless that I would end my existence. And from that point forward, I just felt a little bit closer to myself and a lot closer to a higher energy, because I really felt at that point that I was really getting steered in a different direction.
Yeah. Yeah, well, first I want to say thank God you're here with us. I mean, that and I think a lot of times we've all had our dark days. We've all had our dark times. But it's those dark times that you actually have the aha moment a lot of times. And I've heard that time and time again from a lot of people in different walks of life where, you know, where I was going through this dark time. And that is when I had that epiphany. That's when God came to me. That's when whatever they choose to call their higher power came to me. That sure is, as a reading, when you're reading somebody, do you find that to be basically a theme going through. People tend to find things when they are at their lowest.
Yeah, I have to tell you, yeah, there's always a bottom that each one of us at some point in our life has felt, and the only way is up from that point. And many of the people that I've read, there's a bottom to things, you know, and death for a lot of people is that, especially when the relationships are so enmeshed and they have this loss for them. Sure. That is big.
Yeah. Well, yeah. Yeah.
And they can't imagine living, you know, so that kind of bottom, if you will, that sense of what helps life to get kind of created, this sense of I can withstand it, I can get through it, I can handle it. It builds muscles in a way, as sad as that is, but it builds muscles.
Wow, very cool.
Armand, I have a few questions. I'm very, very interested in the process, and it's I just marvel at what you've been through and what you've turned it into. And I liked very much what you said toward the beginning about seeing this gift as a responsibility, and that you have a responsibility to people, and this isn't just a show. So I appreciate that very much. I was wondering, one of the things that occurred to me is when you're in the process of bringing or channeling this information, how much of you is in there and how much of it is that you are simply a conduit?
I absolutely love that question, because this is what happens to me. First off, I never remember a reading afterwards. It's like I've woken up from a dream, and I can remember pieces of it, but most of the reading I do not remember at all. At all. And this is within like minutes to a half hour to an hour. It fades. So having said that, when I am reading, I always tell people that you have me in front of you right now, but I'm no longer going to be here once I start this process of breathing, and we do a little bit of breathing. I begin to move way back behind. It's as if I allow the other side to use my body to kind of channel the information to them. Mm-hmm. I'm aware when I'm reading, I'm moving my lips, I'm the one doing the talking, but it's not me, it's them. It's kind of this blend that starts to happen. I'm there and aware, but at the same time, I'm allowing and having trust in the other side to channel through me for that person. Mm-hmm. But often when I come out of the reading, I have to go, wait a minute, I have to come back. And I sometimes have to crack jokes or do something just to kind of reel myself forward.
Add some levity to it a little bit, kind of decompress.
Yeah, absolutely. And when I do group readings, I tend to create and respectful humor, but a level of humor with people. And we're joking a little bit, because it actually just offsets being so deep in there. And then I move to the next person and do it. And then I read them, and then I do a little bit of humor, pulls me out again.
Now, do you read best when person's physically there with you, or you can do it at all forms?
I can do it in all forms. I love it when I'm in front of people, because quite honestly, I love helping people. I really just do. I have definitely Skyped all around the world reading people. To see them kind of helps me. There's something where I'm in the habit of looking past a person to the mm-hmm. energies. I get my information behind them, like around them. And I'm just used to that. But I do it via phone, okay. Skype, FaceTime, all around the world.
Now, that's great to know, because, you know, that way you don't have to fly to you necessarily.
Yeah.
You know? Yeah. And of course, it's a gift, and we've heard from a lot of psychic mediums. In fact, one of our favorite guests has been Amy Allen. I'm sure you're familiar with her, Dead Files, and she had kind of echoed the same thing you're saying. It's not easy. It takes a lot out of you when you do a full-blown reading. Do you ever get what they call the reading hangover?
I got to tell you, no. I have to tell you this. I really, the only time that I really, really, really felt that hangover that you're talking about was, it took me about 3 hours to do it, but I read 35 people, like in a row in a group room setting. This was in Highbridge, New Jersey, and I read 34, 35 in that range. And I really felt very drained afterwards. But after a single read, or even 10 people in a room that I'll be doing tomorrow night in Flemington, you know, I don't feel drained. A slight bit, but I'm okay. I'm actually hungry afterwards. Like, I want to eat a hamburger or something. I need some food.
You know? But, well, that is a lot of energy to expel. And we got a call coming in. I got to add this call because it's... Sure. It's absolutely imperative. I guess I do so, but our call system will not allow me to add this individual at the moment. So that is all right, though. We are here and we are talking, and we talked about the hangover. We talked about the mediumship of on the spot, basically guerrilla mediumship. Now, that being said, and that in the media, because the media fuels a lot of what's going on. What has been positive that you've seen in the last X amount of years that truly has been positive for mediums, so they're not so looked at as, you know, like, oh, it's one of them, you know?
I think the positiveness that's happened is that they've brought through and given the symbolism going, you know, well, you know, your Uncle Ted is here. They've done it by name. They've given items that they could never have known in the past to the person, verifying that they are actually reading the energy that is coming through. I think this is key because when you give an individual this verification of a mug with a letter C on it, or they're showing me radio flyer being written in gold letters, and that happened to me giving a reading to somebody, and it really was the 50th anniversary of the radio flyer wagon they got from their uncle. I mean, that alone, for the mediums out there that have done that, I think that has helped to turn people around and go, wait a minute, there is something on the other side of this veil. There is something on the other side of this, of where we are in this frequency, where we are on this earthly plane.
Sure. Very, very interesting. I like your answer. I really do. I mean, it's a very good answer, and I think it really validates a lot of things, right, Eric?
Absolutely. While you're talking again, it was occurring to me that I had to take a little quick look at the Olympics there.
Oh, sure. You know, I see that.
They're going on
the
stuff.
Side of the office. Take a look at the Olympics.
I'm really very interested in the mechanics of it. We talked a little bit about it, but maybe if you could put it, I noticed on your website, which is excellent, by the way, it's another way you can tell that you're the real thing and that you're doing it for the right reasons. You're very sincere. It really kind of comes through on your website, which seems odd to say, but I really think that's true. So, but you do some defining of, you know, what the terminology is, how things work, whether it be visual, whether it be audio. So maybe if you could run through that a bit and kind of tell us how your particular gifts fit into the various forms of communication with the spirit world.
Okay, that's excellent. What I call all of what I do, okay, let's do this first. A medium is somebody, myself, who is in the middle between the earthly plane, and I say that the earthly plane is at 101 on the FM dial. I stand at 103 in the middle as a medium, and I grab from the 105, the other side. So I grab from that, and I hand it to them, and then it starts flowing through me, because the other side is giving me that information to give to them. Now, when you talk about the different forms of, you know, there's clairaudience, you know, that you hear it, there's clandestine, there's all these names that are put to what I receive as a medium. I receive it in a way, and for me anyway, where it's a knowing. I just know.
Gotcha.
Sometimes I'll see it in my mind's eye. Sometimes it is spelled out in front of me. Sometimes I will hear it, but I don't hear it. It's like I know it. It's just that I know. Mm-hmm. And other times, and quite often, I'm able to be in the place that the energies are describing to me. So I described to somebody, I was in a church, and I described the church, the windows, the pew that they sat in. And very often, by the way, I'm there at the funeral. I'm like, did you sit on the right-hand side, on the left, toward the aisle?
Wow.
And the podium is on the upper left. And I'm in this zone and giving it to them. And they're tearing. And they're like, that's exactly where I was sitting. I said, did your sister or did a female? It looks like a sister, a female. hesitate or stutter when she they're crying. She stumbled over her words when she was doing it and almost couldn't finish. So I actually, and I don't even know what to call that, but I'm actually sitting in the church. I'm actually looking at everything happening. Yeah. I tell people where they sleep in bed. I'm like, you're on the right side if I'm at the foot of the bed. And they're like, yeah. And I said, is there a window to your left, like right next to you? Yeah, you have a very small lamp. It's a small room, isn't it? And that very often is what people are hearing when I'm reading them. So it's feeling it, knowing it, sure. Seeing it. It's almost like this collective that seems to happen. And whatever way they need to give it to me, they give it to me in that way that I'm going to get it to give to them.
Wow. So it's just, it's the delivery from them. And you're, like we were talking about earlier, the conduit.
Yeah.
And it, for lack of a better term, freaks people out just a little bit. I'm assuming it does because you know so many intimate things about them without ever meeting them. How many people go, oh my Lord? I suppose you get that a lot.
It's a little bit of, actually, I got to tell you, in the moment itself, it's less of oh my gosh, what do you do? It's more of we are enveloped together in this journey of bringing the information to that person. They're in it with me on it, and we're both, and they're sort of reveling in the fact that I'm literally in that church, and mm-hmm. It validates them. Or literally, one time I was watching this white thing spinning in the air by a red barn, and I said, I see your husband there who has passed, and she's bursting mm-hmm. onto tears, and she's saying, that's my son. He was on a motorcycle, and he was in an accident, and the motorcycle was white, and he did a jump, and it was spinning in the air, and he died instantly.
Man!
Right, exactly. Swear to God himself that this is what happens.
Wow.
And it's very, I can't use the word healing because it's frowned upon, in this arena.
Sure.
But it is very validating. It helps the person to complete this circuit or the story and knowing that their loved one actually has reached the other side, because I wasn't standing there when that tragic event happened.
Man, that's crazy. I mean, that in a good way, but I got to absorb that for a minute. We got to run the break. We come back. We're going to talk more with Armand, because it is just, it's not often do we get psychics that are so, or mediums rather, that are just so open about how their ability works. It's a really refreshing. Don't go anywhere. Be right back right after this.
So you're seeing different colors in one ear, out the other. Understand, 'cause I'm not too sure I can lend a hand.
Taking a family of five to the amusement park can cost a small fortune.
Oh, yeah. So to save some money, we thought, hey, let's bring the amusement park to us. Yeah. Go ahead.
All right. Step right up. Step right up, young man. Are you ready to ride the wacky waterfall?
That's just the bathtub with the shower head running.
Nope, it's the wacky waterfall.
It's the shower, Dad.
Waterfall.
Wacky.
There's an easier way to save. To get a free rate quote, go to geico.com. Then buy online, over the phone, or at your local Geico office.
Anavar Media LLC is a dedicated team of professionals committed to helping business development scale and protect their websites, mobile applications, enterprise software solutions in the Northeast Ohio area. Locally owned since 2012, our client-centered values truly sets Anavar apart. Contact us today to learn how you can get 25% off your first project. Call them at 234-380-4852. Again, that's 234-380-4852. Or visit them at www.anavar.com. Again, that's www.anavar.com.
Hi, Tom Baudette. If you can hear me, then you have an internet connection, which means you can do cool things online, like listen to streaming radio, obviously, or watch a video of a monkey washing a cat. Let your freak flag fly. Or you can book a room at a great price at Motel6.com. Isn't the internet wonderful? Everything you want right at your fingertips, and whoa, did not need to see that. I'm Tom Baudet for Motel 6, and we'll leave the light on for you.
In 1999, The Exorcist was voted the scariest movie of all time.
Your daughter doesn't say she's a demon. She says she's the devil himself.
Entertainment Weekly calls it the most viscerally harrowing movie ever made.
That thing upstairs isn't my daughter.
The most electrifying movie of the 20th century is now coming back to theaters.
Where's Reagan?
In here. With us.
Author William Peter Blatty and director William Friedkin have created an expanded, thrilling new version of The Exorcist with footage that has never been seen before.
She needs a priest.
Don't miss The Exorcist in the version you've never seen. Possessing theaters everywhere. Rated R, under 17, not admitted without parent.
Do you have a question for our guest tonight? Don't feel like calling the show? Not a problem. Email those questions to afterhoursam@gmail.com. Again, that's afterhoursam@gmail.com.
Welcome back to After Hours AM, everybody. I'm your host, Joel Sturgis, and we are back on After Hours AM. I'm still blown away, Eric. I really am blown away by our first half hour. It's been very rarely does somebody of Armand's can talk caliber come on the show and talk with us so openly. And on the line currently, we have Miss Jennifer Sturgis. Yes, she is related to me. Yes, I am married to her, and she really appreciates your abilities. Go ahead, Jennifer. I did promise, so there you go. You're on it. You're on the air, by the way, so talk anytime.
Hello.
And there you go.
Hi, how are you?
Oh, I'm good. How are you?
I'm doing just fine.
Good.
Okay. Are you done?
I don't know what to do.
Well, did you have a question?
Yeah.
Not in particular.
Okay, then. Show's over. See you later, guys. all right.
Thoughts or comments on the process or his amazing abilities?
Well, I think it's a real special talent that you have. You know, not very many people can do that, and I think that's amazing.
Thank you so very much. I appreciate that. And I don't know that I'm supposed to read you, but can I give you something?
Yeah, go ahead, Armin. Please do.
There's a male that comes through on your right, my left, that feels very paternal to you. Did you lose a father or a father-like image for you?
I lost my dad.
He comes in behind you. He's saluting me. Was he in the service?
Yep.
Okay, he comes through. You guys, I start to cry when I read sometimes when the energy is very strong for me. Were you guys very close together? Because he's doing this crossover finger like you guys are close together?
We were pretty close.
Okay, because he's giving you pink roses and he's allowing me to see the red one saying I love you, but pink one showing me this I'm sorry that's there. He's playing the Cats in the Cradle song and showing me that, you know, he kind of missed out on some opportunities with you as well. And there's an apologies going around. He's kind of like removed at times. And he talks about doing a word find and never really knowing how to put the words into motion on how he feels in general. But he says he tried to work at it. And he says in hindsight is always 20/20. And he wants to let you know he's always around you. He loves you so much, just so you know.
Oh, wow.
How true is some of that for you?
Well, it was my stepdad.
Okay. Father,
and he was in the service, and he always had a hard time wording things.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Oh. Well, thank you, Jennifer, for calling in, and Armand did a great job, and I felt the emotion as well, actually. And I know that you were very close to your father, and he hit it right on the nail, right on the head. And well, that was great. Well, I will be talking to you soon, so keep listening.
In the real world.
So take care. I'll be talking to you very soon, okay?
Armand, I love the playing. Bye, Jennifer.
Bye, Jennifer. Thank you.
When you said playing the Cats in the Cradle song, because you probably get an awful lot of that. I love that as shorthand, you know, mm-hmm. because it is a powerful song, and people always, I would think people always have regret.
Mm-hmm. They do. You know, I find that it's either one way or the other. Either it's the Cat in the Cradle song, or it's the other way, where there is such a relationship between the two that it's overwhelmingly loving.
Sure.
Like, it's just, you know, was such a loss for them.
Sure. You know, a lot of people are trying to call in. Our call system currently, you guys are overloading it, to be completely honest with you. And we will have Armand back on to do a full reading show at some point in the future. I hate to be the bearer of bad news. It's just that too many of you guys are calling at one time.
Can we do an email?
Yes, please email your questions, simply because it is overloading our call system that I swear a squirrel runs the call system. You know, I didn't beat any nuts today, so, you know. But that being said, I got a question for you, Armand. I never open myself up to the public very often on a personal level. I got a big question for you, sir, and if you don't mind answering.
It's
public knowledge, said it many, many times on the air. I lost my dad some 2 years ago, 2.5 years ago. What do you see? I mean, is he all right? I mean, is things going good for him?
He very much is. Were you guys, did you guys, and I swear to God, before you said that, I was getting a male figure on my, you know, swear to God. Mm. But were you guys very much alike, sound alike, look alike, talk alike, walk, you know, it's like you can.
Yeah, we were very similar to each other. We really were. In fact, I miss him. So, yes.
I see where I did a verification thing, because that's what he's giving me. Did he have a brother that died as well?
He did. He did have a brother.
He brings him through, and he's got his arm around him. And are these, like, comical guys? Like, this is humor between the two of them?
Well, see, I wouldn't know. See, his brother died when he was very small. I think the brother died when he was only, like, 3 or 4 months old. So I never got a chance to meet him. So that very well could have been the case.
Yeah, there's a great deal of love between the two of them, and humor between the two of them, and they're very close. They give me that as verification. And his father, your grandfather, was very patriarchal in the family.
Yes.
Did he kind of lead or head, you know, the family? Was he very strong in the family?
Yeah, he was a take no prisoners, take no guff kind of guy.
Right, very military in a sense, you know, very kind of in that in that role. Your dad says, and you have a picture of you and he. Do you have that in your room before you walk out of the room or within the room of you and he?
I have a picture of him I look at every day. We were there while the picture was being taken.
Okay.
It was not with him and I in it. I do have a picture like that I look at quite often, but I do have a picture of him hanging up.
Okay, because he talks about the picture of you and he, and he was showing me a high boy before you leave the room, like a dresser or something like that. But I guess just showing that you have it and that you look at it. And he wants to let you know that sometimes you get really, really scared at night or at night, not scared, but like all of life comes like storming in.
Oh, yeah.
And he says, I can hear you. I want to let you know that I can hear every word that you say. And you didn't just call him dad. Did you call him pop or dad or some other name besides daddy or something like that?
Pretty much, you know, for me, anyhow, being a boy, I call him just straight up dad usually.
Okay.
Tease him. He hated being called pop. So I call him pop once in a while, you know, just to get under his skin. You know how boys do that once in a while. They're going to get under dad's skin here. And, you know, that kind of stuff. But mainly what I was, he had a rough go of things at the end, of course. I'm sure you're reading that. And I just wanted to make sure he was doing all right. And he made it to the other side.
He talks about being taken before it's time. Were you on his left-hand side when he was passing?
I would have been, yes, towards his left. Yes, sir.
Yeah, because what he's talking about is that he can almost see you toward the end. It's like kind of looking through the slits of his eyes. And he talks about wanting to tell everyone that he loves them before he passes.
Mm-hmm.
And he says, I want to let you know that, and I'm getting very lung-oriented, very lung and very chest. It almost feels like heart and it feels like lung. And he says, it was a relief to pass. He says, it's a relief for me to pass. And he talks about his father coming to get him, and he says it is like going into a warm bath of water. These are his words. He wasn't very much a churchgoer, but he talks about entering into the light of God, and he says that the energy, I absorb the energy in. He said it's like going into a warm bath of water, and he said from being cold, I am instantly warm, and I instantly feel love. And he wants to let you know that I am in not only a much better place, but he says I'm in nirvana. Is what he says. He goes, there's no other feeling like this. No other feeling like this, he says.
Wow. To be completely honest with you, he passed a lung cancer.
Mm-hmm.
And it was a long, drawn-out battle.
Yeah.
Way longer than any of us wanted to see happen. And he did pass quicker than we would assume he would have, and things just took a turn for the worse really quick, and with cancer, and that's the beast that it is. It's kind of like a thief in the night at times,
right,
where it decides to rear its ugly head, it does it really, really quick. And that being said, Armand, I gotta tell you, you're right on the money. I got chills. I darn near choked up there.
Mm-hmm.
Very, very on the money, and very thank you very, very much for validating and letting me know that my father is doing just fine on the other side.
Yeah, very much so.
Because I worry, like everybody, you know, I worried about that. Did he make it? Is he all right? What's he up to? And it sounds like he is doing just fine.
Absolutely. And there's so much more information. You know, one time if you ever want a reading, it's kind of like, and I know we need to be done for the purposes of time, and I get it, but it's like, I'm not done yet. So, it, you know, when you get a chance, if you ever want a reading, and, you know, please feel free, because I'd like to finish things out with you.
Sure, I'd love to. And that being said, with the huge amount of calls that we're receiving that's crashed our phone system, how can people get their very own reading with you if that's something they want to do?
The greatest thing, the best thing that they can do, a lot of times people try to come through the Facebook page and become my friend and then ask for a reading.
Sure.
The best way to do it is to go to www.medium.com. Armand, and that's armand.com. If you go to the request a reading page or request medium Armand, you can fill out the form. Now, you don't have to fill out your last name.
Okay.
You don't have to fill out any identifiables if you're afraid I'm going to read up on you, which I don't. You can just put your contact, your email, maybe your phone number, some way that I can get a hold of you, and the type of service. You'll see it on there. It's easy. The other way that you can, I prefer that way, but the other way that it can be done is through email. MediumArmand@yahoo.com. MediumArmand, so ARMAND. If the phone won't really do much, because it'll pile up as it does with calls.
Yes.
And I only try to send people back over to the website.
Sure.
With the website, it comes through the email, and I can easily go through that.
Sure.
People, if they want to Facebook me, they can go to my fan page. If you type in my name, Armand Egidi, you'll see fan page, and then there'll be my page, you know, that, you know, people who have gotten read come in on, and they give their testimonials and whatnot. But so, you know, people can come in, but I'd rather do it where they go through
yeah,
you can even go to the fan page and click the book it now button and it'll bring them to the website.
Oh, I hear you. I totally get where you're coming from. It's better to have it more of an official channel.
Sure.
You know, like we get a lot of that for radio purposes. Hey, let's become friends on Facebook. Hey, by the way, can I get on After Hours? No, there's better ways of going about that, folks. You know, get on the air. So, I mean,
Armand, I have a question before I forget, because, you know, my mind is like a steel sieve.
A sieve.
So, while you were talking to Joel, which was very, very impressive, that was crazy stuff. Even I was getting tingles from that. It occurred to me, is there any difference when you're reading someone who also has some sort of medium abilities, psychic abilities that they may not even be aware of? Is there any difference there? In other words, is it almost like a meeting of the psychics. You see what I'm saying?
There's a huge difference. When people have a level of the gift or a light work, or they're a medium, mm-hmm. where they're open, it makes it a lot easier because they're giving their permission for me to enter when they are willing and open and not, well, there might be a little bit of fear, and that they are light workers. I am able to really just ebb and flow. End up in tears because sure. it's just hit home what I've said to them. But people that have their arms crossed or they somehow are resistant, it actually doesn't give me permission to enter. It actually does the opposite okay. because their spirit is saying, I don't want you in. And it's not because they won't answer questions. It's really just their spiritual energy has put a wall up.
Sure.
So yes, it makes it easier when people are fellow light workers or are open or spiritual. It actually helps.
One of our avid listeners, her name is Kate, and she has a daughter named Lauren that's getting ready to go to school and or college. And she's very, very nervous, and she has been a wonderful listener to the show. Was kind of one your thoughts on Lauren, her daughter's path moving forward? Is she going to be successful in college? I know she's definitely stressing out about this. Is there any kind of insight you can give her?
Yeah, because I'm pulling stuff through already for her. Yeah, absolutely. I think the thing is it's a wow situation for her in entering into school. It's very new. This is what they're giving me to give to her, that for her to really, as a mom, make sure that her daughter knows that to be her own person, that she doesn't always need to get caught up in making everyone around them pleased, that she is everyone's friend and everyone, to be careful of that, because that's the one warning. It's kind of like a yellow triangle
sure.
because she wants to fit in, and that's the direction. The success is there. It kind of hinges on whether or not she goes toward the fun, too much fun of the college, or if she goes the other way and doesn't, and she can manage herself doing a blend of the two. And that's what they're bringing through for me with her. And actually, I like her daughter's energy, and she's really a great energy, and so is the mom. And there's a closeness that they show with the two of them being together, that there is a level of closeness. But she needs to learn how to manage the two worlds, and that's the biggest piece of it. So success, yes, but future is very hard to denote because there's free will that starts happening. So yeah. If one way, yes. If the other way, there could be some stumbling blocks and some turbulence.
Gotcha. Well, there you go. I mean, that's the answer, and I think that I think she'll be just fine personally, and I think that she'll find her way. At least that's what we all pray. Because college is so overwhelming when you hit it. It's I remember those old days going to college, and like I always say, I majored in beers and girls, beer and girls. That's what I majored in for a long time. But, as you are... Do you get asked a lot of health questions from people when you're doing readings? And if so, do you ever feel like uncomfortable answering a health question?
Never do I feel uncomfortable, because check out what happened today. A gal sat down for a reading she wanted to come back for, and she said to me, she said, "You saved my life." And I was like, and I don't remember the readings. So I just go, "Oh, okay, well, what happened? What?" And mm-hmm. she said, "You told me my mother was showing me a big D. And that big D for me is diabetes for somebody. Little D as you may have it, you got to be careful."
Mm-hmm.
She said, "I went to the doctor and that's exactly what was happening. Exactly that I had diabetes." And there was a few other things that she had mentioned as well that corroborated with what she found out from the doctor. Then later on today, I had gotten a message through Facebook of somebody thanking me because I had brought through that her dad might have cancer and needs to go to the doctor to get checked out. And she messaged this big thank you to me saying her father indeed has stage 1 cancer. So it's stuff like that that I bring through. And I love that, because in some regards, and they're telling me it's saving lives, that it really helps people,
Yeah, I think you're absolutely correct. It is saving lives. And it's an early warning system as well that, mm-hmm. Maybe this person wouldn't have caught it in time.
Absolutely.
When you are doing a health reading, you're in essence, I mean, it's a little different in that you're peering literally, I guess, into a person's body. Or are you still getting the information from outside?
It's from the other side.
Ah, I see.
Yeah, it's not from me. It's what I get to give to the person.
Okay.
From
okay.
The other side.
So you're not peering into their body. You're getting information about their body from the other side.
I got to tell you, as you're asking me this, I'm trying to access how that feels when it's happening. And it's almost a little of both that happens as I scan through. I'd say it's about 80% the other side, 70%, and maybe 20% sure. of me. Sure. Because I'm always a part of things, but the conduit.
Okay.
Right.
And I also want to apologize again to all the listeners that keep calling in. Our phone system is currently down. You guys have overloaded it and broke it. But if you would like a reading, of course, you can always go to the website, of course, which is, of course, mediumarmand@.com. If I'm not, you know, destroying your name, because it's, you know, I'm good at that. Just ask Eric. I'm horrible with names sometimes. I'm like,
no, you know, I'll tell you, my first name is Armand, but okay. A lot of people say Armand, and okay. I literally answer to both, and I can't tell the two apart anymore.
Do you ever feel exotic when people call you like Armando? Hello, Armando.
Yeah, Armando.
Do you ever go, come back with an Antonio Banderas accent and go, yes.
It's funny because my dad, or they always say, oh, Armand, I like that. Yeah, Armand in the birdcage. And I'm like, all right, can we say Armand Asante? Can we just give it a little, you know?
Sure. And, you know, and that's interesting that we bring that up. I mean, of course, your website, because if you go there, not only can you learn more about you, but you can also see the skills that you've honed and that you offer, because you're not just a medium. You're clairvoyant as well. I mean, you have a lot of different skill sets that are impressive, my friend.
Thank you so much. You know, and it's like when somebody comes to me, it's almost like whatever needs to be accessed just happens, mm-hmm. and it just goes to that. Sometimes a reading is people don't want to hear from the ones who have passed, believe it or not.
Sure.
They don't want to hear from them and say, no, I want more of a reading of you telling me where I am and where I'm going. And then some people want the balance of both, and I do that. Actually, that's most of the time what I do.
Okay, Armand, we're going to ask you the $64,000 question we've asked every psychic on this show.
Sure.
Ever. And it's a selfish one that Eric and I have. Where do you see After Hours AM going?
it seems like to me, there's. Do you really want me to answer?
Yeah.
Okay. But it seems like to me, they're talking about levels of advertising and going out there. But something recently just happened where it steered things in a different direction for you guys for After Hours. There's somebody that you either joined up with or matched with or started with, and there's a new horizon that's coming up. There's somebody you merged with or somebody that has interest in you.
Sure.
That is freaking amazing.
Isn't that because my
face hurt.
Because we got a couple opportunities just like that. One of them, of course, is with a very gifted individual named Steve Asher that will be coming on air. And he's a very, very skilled radio personality as well as author. And, of course, that's my end. And then Eric has something going. That's so weird, man. It just blew
really
my
weird.
Flipping
hey,
mind.
That is crazy. You're absolutely right. And we are looking to kind of expand, re-expand. We had to contract about a year ago. Now we're re-expanding, and I think that's very exciting. And wow, yeah, I mean, you hit the nail on the head real quick, because we are literally down to the last few minutes. I'm very, very interested, back to something you said at the very beginning of the show, your Thursday night group. How do you work with people to bring out their abilities?
Well, I have a group that I've mixed the beginners and intermediates together, but I'm thinking of separating them a little bit just to – because the beginners – okay, too much to explain. But I work with them in helping them to get into the zone, to learn what that zone is that they sure. get into, where they can grab from that highway of information from the other side. And I teach them how to kind of meditate down to that level and take what's on the surface. I'm about to branch off and start a new office space in Flemington, and it's going to be called The Knowing, and on 50 Stengel Road in Flemington. This is such a cool spot. It's got a kiln in it that's 8 feet in diameter, where I'm going to be doing singing bowls, meditation groups in there, readings in there, and the rest of the room is available to me. And it's such a unique spot, and I cannot wait September 1 to begin to do readings in there.
Sounds great, man. Sounds awesome. Looking forward to hearing more. More from you, and then having you back on the show, of course. We really look forward to having you come back on. And in the meantime, of course, I want to recap how people can get a reading, how they can get a hold of you, all that kind of good stuff.
Okay. People, if they go to my website, www.mediumarmand.com, that's the best way, and click on the request medium Armand or request a reading. I'm forgetting what it says. You'll see it. Click on that. Fill out the form and send it in. Again, you can fill out as much or as little information as you want, but please make sure you give me your first name and your phone number or an email address at the least. And then you can request the times and where and all that on there. The other way is if you want to remain private, and I do read a lot of actors and actresses and people that are pretty high up in the entertainment industry, and in many industries, I should say, just got back from California doing that. They tend to like to email me for the privacy end of it, and just to email, and that's fine too. So mediumarmand@yahoo.com.
Perfect.
If you want that level and you don't want to go through a website and you just want it email to email, that's the best way to do that.
Well, perfect. Thank you again so much for coming on the show, and on beyond. I'm blown away, man. I can barely talk. I'm totally blown away over here. But on behalf of myself, Joel Sturgis, and Mr. Eric Olsen, we'd like to thank you for listening to this edition of After Hours AM. Take care of each other, love each other, and more importantly, keep an open mind about everything, because the open mind, nothing's ever closed an open mind, if I can ever spit that out. See you guys next time.
Thank you for listening to this edition of After Hours AM, and please remember to like us on Facebook and also follow us over on Twitter.